So today we're going to have a look at translocation. So translocation is the movement of what's called assimilates through the plant, through that phloem tissue. And so assimilates can be sucrose, so the plant makes glucose. Glucose is more reactive than sucrose, so it quickly converts it into sucrose. Assimilates might also be amino acids. So the movement through sit tube elements, the movement through phloem tissue, is the movement of assimilates. So today we're going to concentrate on sucrose. But anytime I'm talking about sucrose, it could be amino acids. It's just how the plant moves those assimilates through it. So we're going to have a look at something called a source and a sink. Now a source is anywhere where these assimilates will move in to the sieve tube elements. So that might be a place where there is photosynthesis and that sucrose has been made and it is put into the sieve tube element to be moved to the plant. It might be the a potato tuber, which is a store of starch, and in the new growing season, it wants to break that starch down and then move those sugars to the site of respiration for new growth for the new season. And then we're going to have a look at a sink. A sink is anything that moves the sucrose out of the sieve tube element. So that could be somewhere that is actively respiring, so new shoots, new roots at the beginning of the growth season. It could also be that potato tuber at the end of the summer where it's laying down stores. It moves the sucrose into the potato to lay it down and store it as starch. So we're going to have a look at both of these. Now, I have got two diagrams here. One, we're going to do what's called loading. So that is a source. So loading happens at a source when you're moving sucrose and assimilates into the sieve tube element. Unloading is what happens at a sink when you move the sucrose out of the sieve tube element. So we've got xylem here, which runs alongside your phloem tissue, and your phloem tissue comprises of sieve tube elements with those pores in your sieve end plates and companion cells. These are essential because your sieve tube elements can't do a lot of those processes. They only have a small amount of cytoplasm, all that kind of stuff. So the first thing we're going to have a look at is loading. How do we get the sucrose into the sieve tube element? So let's imagine we've got a cell that's been photosynthesizing. It's been producing all these assimilates. It wants to move them into your sieve tube element. So the first thing that happens is these companion cells actively transport out hydrogen ions. So they just actively transport hydrogen ions out into these surrounding tissues. So this hydrogen ion concentration builds up. And what happens is these hydrogen ions want to move back into the companion cells. But when they do that, they take with them the sucrose. So active transport of hydrogen ions out, build up hydrogen ion concentration, movement of hydrogen ions back into the companion cells, but bringing sucrose with it. It is a co-transport. And so the hydrogen ions and sucrose move together through co-transport proteins. So the hydrogen ions and sucrose can't move through on their own. They need to move through together into those companion cells. Now what happens is when you start to move the sucrose in, you start to build up a concentration gradient. You start to build up how much sucrose is there. And so the sucrose that builds up in these companion cells just diffuses, moves into the sieve tube elements. Now what that does is it increases the solute concentration. And if you increase the solute concentration, you are going to decrease the water potential. Now, these run alongside xylem, and if you remember, xylem have these pores, these pits, to allow for lateral movement of water. So if you reduce the water potential here, because you've moved your sucrose in, then water will leave the xylem to try and equal out that water potential gradient. So water moves out of the xylem. So we've increased the solute concentration, and then we've put water into this area down that water potential gradient. So what happens in this area is you increase something called the hydrogen. hydrostatic pressure. So it increases, you've got a high hydrostatic pressure here. So high hydrostatic pressure at the site where you are loading. So at the source, where you are loading your sucrose, you get high hydrostatic pressure. Now if you remember when we did tissue formation and we did the circulatory system, we talked about mass flow. Now mass flow is the movement of fluid from high hydrostatic pressure to low hydrostatic pressure. So mass flow is from high pressure to low pressure. So we've created an area of high pressure. Now we need to create an area of low pressure. Now I'm going to have a look at this bottom bit of the diagram. This could happen below where you've got your source, or it could happen above. Sources and sinks can be above or below each other. It doesn't matter because remember the flow, through flow can be up or down. So let's have a look at a sink. So let's imagine we've got a cell that wants to respire, it's growing for something. And so what happens is the sucrose that is inside the sink tube element will move out. Now that can be by active transport or diffusion, it doesn't matter. So it can be actively transported or it can diffuse, but the sucrose will move out. Now when you move the sucrose out, you are going to increase your water potential because you're removing some of those solutes. If you increase the water potential, this water will move back into the xylem. Okay, so remember that xylem is moving, is running parallel to the sieve tube elements. So when you move sucrose out, you increase the water potential, so water will move back into the xylem. And what that does in this area is reduce your hydrostatic pressure. So now we have an area of high hydrostatic pressure and we have an area of low hydrostatic pressure. And so what happens is mass flow means that these assimilates will flow from where there is high hydrostatic pressure to where there is low hydrostatic pressure. And that's how assimilates are moved through flowing tissue, and how sucrose is moved up or down the sieve tube elements.